हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू द लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ 8085 माइक्रो प्रोसेसर। टुडे वी विल बी लर्निंग सम एडिशनल टेक्निक्स लाइक लूपिंग, काउंटिंग एंड इंडेक्सिंग। सो वी स्टार्ट विद द लूपिंग। लूपिंग इज़ अ प्रोग्रामिंग टेक्निक विच इंस्ट्रक्ट्स द माइक्रो प्रोसेसर टू रिपीट टास्क। सो इट माइट हैपन दैट वी हैव सम टास्क विच हैज़ टू बी रिपीटेड। सो दिस लूपिंग इंस्ट्रक्शन इज दिस लूपिंग टेक्निक इज यूज टू रिपीट दोज टास्क। So we use a loop. We use some instructions which run like a loop. Okay. So loop can be used to change the sequence of execution and perform the task again. So by using this loop, we can change the sequence of execution so that we can run some instructions again and again. Now here loops can be classified into two types. As we can see here, there are two types of loops. One is the continuous loop. Other is the conditional loop. Continuous loop, it is made to run forever. There are some programs which are made to run forever. Okay. So in those case we use the continuous loop, and sometimes we need some conditional loops. These conditional loops, they repeat the task when a specific condition is satisfied. Let us first see the continuous loop. Continuous loop means this loop is set up by using unconditional jump instruction. So we know in case of microprocessor 8085 there is only one unconditional jump, that is called that is JMP. Okay. So we use for getting this unconditional jump, we use JMP instruction. So this particular loop, continuous loop, it runs forever. So sometimes we need to run a program forever, so that for that purpose we need this continuous loop. This will never stop until we stop the system itself. So this is the flowchart of a continuous loop. As we see, suppose we have some task to be performed. So this is the task, whatever the task may be. So we start, perform the task, okay, go back and repeat. So this is repeated again and again. This is repeated. So this, we can see, this is a never-ending loop. This will go on continuously doing, performing this task. Let us see one example how we can write us a program. Like if I start with 8000, I write MVIA 1515H. This is a 2-byte instruction, so I have to leave one gap. Then MVM 1 byte, so MV at 8002. If I write this move A comma B comma A, this is B comma A. So this is move B comma A. And then I give a jump instruction 8003 JMP 8000. So of course this will take 2 bytes, at three bytes total, so 8005. Now what this instruction will do when we run this program, so at 8000 it will transfer the data 15H in A, then transfer A to B, and then jump to 8000. So it will jump to 80. So this particular instruction is it will run a never ending program. It will never end. It will go on until unless we shut down the system. Okay, so this is how a continuous loop is generated. The next is the conditional loop. So this conditional loop is set up by using a conditional jump instruction. So as we know, there are 8 conditional jumps in case of 8085 microprocessor. So any of that particular jump can be used to check that particular condition, and we can generate that conditional jump instruction. So let us see. Of course it will depend on which jump we have to, what RAM we are using, so that the programmer may decide which jump to use and where to use that jump. So out of that 8 jump, so this is a simple flowchart of a conditional jump. So here suppose we want to perform a task 5 times. So in that case, first of all, the very first step is to set up the counter for the 5 task. Then next step is to perform the task and reduce the count by 1. And then here, see, this is the condition. We are checking whether the counter is set to 0 or not. If it is not set to 0, we come back here, again perform the task, then reduce the count, again check for 0. So this task will go on continuously until the counter becomes 0. So by the time the counter becomes 0, the task would be performed 5 times. So this is how we use the conditional loop. Let us see one example for this conditional loop. Suppose we want to add the contents of register A 5 times. Some data is stored in register A and we have to add that 5 times. So the very first task is we have to store 05H in register C. So this is the count 5 in register C. Then the task is to add the data byte. So add A, we have to add A. Then we have to decrement the count DCRC, and here we have to check the condition. This part, this is the counter 0 part. So this is JNZ 8003. Then here at 8006 and 8007, this is a 3 byte instruction, and finally here we have 8008, we have the halt instruction. So this particular condition, this is the conditional loop. MVIC 05, add A will add the contents of A with itself, then DCRC will decrement this count by 1, and JNZ will check whether C is 0 or not. So as long as C is not 0, this will go on to 8003. So at 8003 we are adding A again, DCRC, this will continue until C becomes 0. As and when C becomes 0, we have added this A 5 times. So this is how we use the conditional loop. Now next we will see a generalized programming flowchart. So these are some of the blocks which may be the part of any of the program. It may happen that some blocks may not be there in a particular program, and some may be repeated more than once in a program, but these blocks will be the part of the particular program. The very first part of the program is the initialization part. This is the very first block that is called the initialization. This is one of the very most important part of the program, because as we say, well begun is half done. So the very first thing is we must properly initialize the program. What memory, if we are using memory, then which memory pointer should we use, where to initialize. If we are using a counter, so what should be the count, which register to be used. So this is the very most important, the extremely important part of the program. Then second part is the data acquisition part. So how to acquire the data? The data may be in a memory, the data may be somewhere in the, maybe from the input output. So how to acquire the data? This is the second part. Then the third part is the data processing. The third block is the data processing block. So it may happen that we may need to add the data byte, or maybe subtract, or maybe rotate, any other operation we have to perform on that particular data byte. So this comes the how to process the data. Then the next block is the temporary storage of the partial results. It may happen that our particular operation is a little bit complex operation, so we need to store the result temporarily before processing to the next part. So we need to store the data temporarily. So we must see how to store the data. Then next is getting ready for the next operation. This is the, we can say this is the first, second, third, fourth, and this is the fifth block. So the fifth block is concerned with getting ready for the next operation. So it may happen that we have some blocks of memory. So we have done the operation on the first particular memory location, we have to proceed for the second memory location, or we have some tasks, so we have to perform many number of tasks, so we have to get ready for the next task, next operation. So this is this part that is getting ready for the next operation. Then the next block, the number sixth block, is a decision making block. Decision making means what? Whether our task, all the operations are complete or not. So if they are complete, then we have to give the output. If they are not complete, then we have to repeat and go to the very go to the upper block, where it may be like data acquisition part. Then the last block is to display the result, display the output. So display means we have to give send the output, maybe to any output device or any of the register or any of the memory location, and then we have to stop. So this is the generalized programming flowchart. Now we'll see some additional instructions apart from whatever we have done. So the very first instruction is the LXI instruction. So this is LXI RP 16 bit. So LXI, the full form of LXI RP 16 bit, is actually load register pair immediate with the 16 bit data. So this is a 3-byte instruction. It loads a 16-bit data into specific register pair. Okay, so the given register pair can be BC, D, HL, or it can be a stack pointer. So let us study with this an example. So suppose if we have this instruction, if I write this LXI, suppose I write LXI B 1020. Now first of all, we must know that there are three register pairs in case of 8085, BC, DE, HL. So when we write LXI B 1020, so 10 gets stored in B and 20 gets stored in register C. So this LXI instruction is a 3-byte instruction. It is equivalent to MVI B, 10H and MVI C, 20H. So this will take actually 4 bytes, but this can be even done with a 3-byte instruction. We can say 1 byte. So LXI B 1020 will store 10 in B and 20 in C. Then one more example. Suppose if we write LXI H 5060. So this will store 50 in register 50 in register H, and because HL, so L is 60. And we have LXI D. If I write 1716, so D will contain 17, and E will contain, E will be 60 will be stored in register E. And then we also have LXI SP. So this is for stack pointer, initialization of the stack pointer. Okay, of course here data will be maybe anything, F, anything. Okay, so there are only 4 LXI instructions: LXI B, LXI D, LXI H, and LXI SP. There is no LXI A, there is no LXI C, there is no LXI E, there is no LXI L. So these are the 4 LXI instructions in case of 8085. Now next is the LDA instruction. So LDA 16-bit address. So LDA is, the full form is load accumulator direct. So this is a 3-byte instruction. It loads the register A with the contents of memory location pointed by the 16-bit memory address. So let us see with an example. Suppose we have this particular memory. I'll just draw the memory locations. These are the memory locations. Okay, memory location in case of 8085, it starts from 0000 and goes up to FFFF. The memory location addresses of 16 bit, the data inside this is of course 8 bits. So suppose if we have at this point, we have 8040 somewhere here, then maybe we have somewhere here 8050. And suppose the data stored here is, suppose I will just write the data here. Suppose we have 10 and here 1 to 12. Okay. So these are the data stored in this particular memory locations. Suppose now if we write LDA 8040. So this, the full form is load accumulator direct 8040. So what it will do, it will load the contents or store the contents of this memory location into register A. So what is inside this? This is 10 is there. So A 10 will be stored in A because of this particular instruction. Now next, suppose if we write LDA 8050. Suppose we write LDA 8050. So A will, the data from this memory location will get stored in register A. So this destination is only A, there is no other register. We cannot store the contents of memory directly into any other register except A. So this instruction is LDA. So LDA will store the contents of the given specific memory location into register A. Similarly, we have a STA. As we have LDA, we have another instruction that is called as STA. So STA instruction is also a 3-byte instruction. It is store accumulator direct. So suppose now if we have suppose register A contains 19H, and if we write STA 8040, so this instruction will store the content of register A into this memory location. So this will become this particular memory location. I will just erase it. So this 19, this will get stored in this particular memory location 1. This will become 19. And suppose if we write STA8050, okay, so the content of this particular memory location, okay, they will change according to register A. So A contains 19, so this 19 will get stored at this location, so this will become 19. So this is STA and LDA. So you must remember this LDA and STA, they are addressing the destination may be A, the source may be A, and it may be another memory location, from memory location or to the memory location, and this only for register A, and both the instructions are of 3 byte. So that's all for this particular session. So we have some more additional instructions. This instruction we will do in the next lecture. Thanks for watching.